So welcome to the last lecture of this course L40. In this lecture what we will do is we will study theory related to virtual work method, and also we will compare the results of virtual work based force calculation with MST based force calculation, as well as with that from an analytical formula. So to start with, let us understand this energy balance in electromechanical devices. So now electrical energy is equal to field energy plus mechanical energy in any electromechanical device like a rotating machine, for example. So now electrical input is basically, now this WE is the electrical input to the motor, and then that will be equal to the field energy plus mechanical energy. This also will include losses. One can, in a more accurate model, losses in the corresponding three components can also be accounted for in this equation. So now dWme, change in mechanical energy, will be equal to the change in electrical energy minus change in field energy. Now dWe is, we know it is eidt, right? E is the voltage, I is the current. So ei gives you power, power into time is energy. And we also know the and E also is basically EMF. So induced voltage EMF is nothing but rate of change of flux linkages, lambda is flux linkage. And then that is why dWe will be given by I d lambda by dt into dt. So that gives you I d lambda as change in electrical energy. So, but one may argue that E is equal to d by dt of Li, and then that can be written as L di by dt, right, if we assume L as constant. And here lambda is substituted by Li because L is flux linkage upon current is L, so that is substituted here, and then we get this if we assume L as constant. So then dW will be Ei dt, and then we substitute here E, substitute expression of E here, so L di by dt into I dt, and then you get lambda di. So we are getting, that means, two expressions. One is I d lambda, and again we are getting another expression as lambda di. Now let us understand what is this lambda di. However, we should keep in mind that in moving systems, L is function of time, and thus representing E as L di by dt is physically incorrect, because E should be then written as this, because L also is changing with time in a typical rotating machine. Also co-energy, this actually later on we will see that this actually is representing the co-energy. So this I d lambda is energy, lambda di is co-energy. Now in basics of electromagnetics we had seen, I is corresponding to H, lambda is corresponding to B. So this is nothing but HdB, this is representing HdB. So HdB is change in corresponding energy density. Here it is, this is representing BdH. So this is co-energy density, and the corresponding, it is showing the change in co-energy density. If it is H, if it is taken as BdH, whereas lambda di is has the unit of energy, right? So this is co-energy. So also it should be remembered that co-energy, which is integral lambda di, is a non-physical quantity, which will be demonstrated later in this lecture. Now consider a relay structure as shown here, and this is a hinged armature with this as pivot. And now once you pass the current in this coil here, this armature will get attracted, and suppose that it moves along this x direction by a very small delta x distance, then the operating point would shift from A to B. So initially, if the characteristic curve was this for a particular gap, after it has moved by delta x, the operating point shifts on this curve from A to B along this line. Now here why it becomes like this? Because of the fact that reluctance is going down because this air gap is reducing, right? So then your flux in the circuit will increase. You know, when you go from A to B, flux is going up and current is going down. So basically then we have two options to simplify our force calculations. Either we can assume flux as constant, that means we approximate this AB, instead of AB we can approximate it as AE, so that it will be constant flux condition when the operating point shifts from this curve to this curve. Or the second case is we can approximate constant current condition when the operating point shifts from this blue curve to black curve, then it will be moving, the operating point would be moving from A to B dash. So in both these cases there is approximation. In the first case, when we are assuming constant flux condition, right, so we are basically neglecting this EAB area and the corresponding energy, whereas in the second case when we are assuming constant current case, we are in fact considering additional area and the force calculated would be higher. In the first case, the force calculated would be lower than actual. So now we will see the advantage and disadvantage of using both these approaches, and we will eventually understand that keeping constant current, that means considering this shift as A to B dash, this condition is easier to implement while doing calculations, and then we end up using co-energy based force computation method. So now let us see in detail the two approaches that I just now briefly discussed. So approach one is constant flux case. This is the characteristics for the initial position of the armature, and A is the operating point of the magnetic circuit in this position, and then it goes to the other curve and the new operating point is this E, and it is this AE, they are on the same horizontal line. So field energy at the initial position corresponds to area of OACO, this highlighted area. Field energy after the moment of delta x, the field energy would be represented by OECO area. So change in field energy will be simply dWf as difference in the two areas that I just now discussed. And remember, this is why these are all field energies, because we are calculating integral I d lambda. So integral I d lambda is the energy, field energy, that is also equivalent to integral h dB, because I corresponds to h, lambda corresponds to b. So this is nothing but also integral h dB, but then that would represent energy density, because unit of HdB will be, you know, energy, you know, the joules per meter cube, whereas lambda into I, the unit is energy, that is joules. Okay. So going further, so change in electrical energy fed by the source here in this case is 0, because lambda is not changing, because we are considering constant flux case. So d lambda is 0, right? So I d lambda is 0. So now we know from the very first slide that dWm, change in mechanical energy, is change in electrical energy minus change in field energy. And since dW is 0, you have dWm as equal to minus dWf. Now dWm is nothing but fdx, force into the distance, right. So fdx you get it as minus dWf, and then eventually then you can calculate f as minus dWf by dx with lambda, the total flux linkage being held as constant, right. So now you know, this effectively what we are doing, the difference in two energies is basically this area AE, OAEO is the change in the field energy, right, and the corresponding energy density would be integral HdB in joules per meter cube. Now this is, you know, absolutely there is no problem here from the point of view of, you know, basic principles. The force should be, you know, positive number. Now dWf by dx is negative, because Wf is reducing. So minus of this minus gives you plus F. So that also is, you know, verified. So in approach 2, now what we will do here, we are keeping current as constant. So we are going from A to B dash, right. So now originally we were at operating point A, then we went to operating point B dash, right. And the field energy at the initial position is represented by OACO area. Field energy after the moment is area OB dash DO. So change in field energy is the difference of the two areas. So OB dash DO minus OACO. So if we actually, you know, represent the areas as given here, so CE B dash DC, CE B dash DC as 1, then OAEO, this blue one as 2, and this triangle, more or less this is a triangular area, that triangular area is EA B dash E is 3, then you know dWf is given by 1 minus 2 areas. The difference in areas 1 and 2 and 3 does not contribute. Now this dWe we have seen earlier, it is I d lambda. So now once we have moved from A to B dash, this much electrical input has increased in the system. So this is representing I d lambda. So that is nothing but area 1, area 1 is this, and area 3, which is E A B dash E, so that is 1 plus 3. So now dWe minus dWf, which is dWm, can be represented as 1 plus 3, just now we saw this is 1 plus 3 dWe, dWf is 1 minus 2. From the previous slide, in the previous slide we just saw this, dWf is 1 minus 2. Will be equal to the change in mechanical energy. So, 1 plus 3 minus of 1 minus 2 will be simply 2 plus 3, and that is what we are getting. This area was OAEO is area 2, and this EAB dash E was designated as area 3. So, you get 2 plus 3, and now you can see here this area is basically representing the change in co-energy, because now if you actually find out this area by difference of two areas, which are those areas? Now what you do, you calculate integral B dH or integral lambda dI, then the original operating point was A, so the corresponding area will be the area under this curve, under OA curve with H or I as the reference axis. So, then we get integral B dH or integral lambda dI. So, this was the
initial co-energy.
When the operating point is approximated to shift to point B dash, the area co-energy is represented by area under this curve, which is under the curve OEB dash. So, effectively now you can see there is increase in co-energy, there is increase in co-energy, and that is something that means effectively the potential energy of the system has increased, which should not be the case, and in that sense co-energy is non-physical, right. So, you cannot get both co-energy also increasing as well as kinetic energy in terms of moment also increasing. So, both are increasing in this case, which is non-physical. But then this approach has some advantage, we will see. So, dWm then is given by dW minus dWf, that is area OA B dash OA B dash O, which is nothing but change in co-energy, and this is nothing but dWm is FdX, dWm is FdX, and this difference is dWCO, change in co-energy. So, finally, you get F as dWCO upon dX with current held constant. It is basically dual of energy, a non-physical quantity which I explained, and co-energy is used with virtual work principle to calculate the forces and torques in rotating machines. So, in terms of FEM coding, what is the advantage of using co-energy? We will see now. In simulations of moving systems, it is easy to keep current as constant since it is a circuit quantity, and therefore, co-energy based calculations are easy with current being held constant. In contrast, magnetic circuit change leads to corresponding change in flux linkage lambda, and this lambda is not easy to control. It is not easy to enforce constant flux condition during during the FEM simulations. That is why we use co-energy based force computation method, and that is being demonstrated now. Now, in order to verify our virtual work based force computation method, first let us calculate analytically the force value, and in L39 we have already calculated force using MST, using the MST method. So, then we will compare all the three values. So, analytically we can calculate, because this is a fairly simple problem and corresponding geometry. So, this geometry was already described in L39. So, this is a core or it is also armature, but it is this armature is not hinged, it is free, and it will get, moment you pass the current, this core will get attracted to this to this C shaped core. So now the air gap here is 0.04 meters, reluctance is L by mu 0 times area S. So now there are two air gaps, so the total reluctance in this magnetic circuit, because since there are two air gaps, there are two lengths, two air gaps, so 2 into 0.04 upon mu 0 into area. What is the area? Area through which the flux is crossing. So one, of course, dimension of the area is this 0.01, and other dimension is 1 meter depth in z direction, because we are going to calculate as usual the performance parameter, that is force, per unit length in z direction. This is in xy plane. Okay, that is why it is 0.01 into 1, and then this gets calculated as this number. MMF, magnetic motive force, is ampere turns, is equal to 100 are the number of turns into I, 362.04. This was actually calculated in L39. So Ni is this. So flux is MMF upon reluctance. So then that gets calculated as so many Webers, and B is flux upon area. So flux is this upon area, 0.1 into 1. I just now explained why area is this. So the flux density is 0.569 Tesla in each gap, in each of these two gaps. So energy in two gaps together is twice B square upon twice mu naught is the energy density into volume, because this is energy per unit volume, into volume, S into area into length, into 2, because there are two gaps. So that gives, after substituting all the values, you get the energy as this. And then force is energy upon length, force into distance is energy. So it is energy by this distance, because this entire core moves in this direction by 0.04 meters. So we are here, we are not considering in small incremental distance, we are considering the total moment through this 0.04 meters, and we are calculating the force for that complete moment of 0.04 meters, and then you get the force as 2.57 into 10 raised to 4 Newton per meter, because again I explained you, we are calculating per unit length in z direction because of 2D approximation, so you get Newtons per meter. We had already calculated using the MST approach in L39, so this slide in fact is from L39 only, so we had seen it there, and we in fact calculated their force as 2.7 into 10 raised to 4 Newton per meter. Now we will calculate using co-energy, using the co-energy approach or the virtual work method approach seen in this lecture L40. So here again these are the two FEM simulations, one with higher distance and one with smaller distance, after virtually displacing this core or armature, or even it is called as in literature plunger. So by some distance, small distance along this direction, and then find out the energies in both these positions, take the difference, which will give you dWCO, divided by the distance by which this core plunger or armature is moved, which is in fact phi mm in this case, and co-energy at position 1 is this, co-energy in position 2 is this. Now you can see here co-energy has increased, right. So as was explained here, in this case when operating point is approximated to have shifted from A to B dash, there is increase in this co-energy which is represented by this shaded area. So that is what we are also getting by simulation. There is increase in co-energy and then the force is calculated as this. So it is coming as 2.28 into 10 raised to 4, whereas the MST based force calculation gave the force as 2.71 into 10 raised to 4, and our analytical formula based value of force was 2.57 into 10 raised to 4. So all these three values, 2.28, 2.71 and 2.57 in one of the previous slides, all are in the same range. So that gives us confidence in all our calculation approaches. Now these are very simple problem to analyze. As I have been mentioning in this course, you start with very simple problems, verify with analytical formulae or some other methods, get confidence in the procedure that you are adopting, and then go on to solve more complex problems. Finally, we will see how do we calculate reluctance torque on a simple rotating machine. Now here this is like a rotating structure which moves in this gap. Now this is again a core which is excited by this coil. So a flux is established and
this rotating structure tends to rotate toward minimum reluctance position.
So that means when it is in this position, torque would be acting to move this so that it gets aligned and becomes vertical, right. So what we will do, again the same thing, we can develop our own code or use any commercial FEA software to model this. So using a code developed based on the theory that was discussed, we get here co-energy for position 1 as this, for position 2 as this, and then the torque is dwco by d theta. So the difference between these two numbers divided by the angular displacement, which is 0.18 radian or 10.31 degrees, you get torque as 0.2895 newton meter. So this is how we can calculate torque using co-energy based approach. With this last case study, our course is completed. Now I just want to summarize using this slide what are all things that we have covered. So in first 10 lectures we covered basics of electromagnetics relevant to electrical machines and equipment, finite element method and finite element analysis. And then we in these 10 lectures some of the concepts were explained through practical examples and virtual electromagnetic laboratory developed in E department of IIT Bombay. In lectures 11 to 16
we understood
fundamental principles of finite element method. In the next 5 lectures
we studied
2 dimensional finite element formulation and the corresponding coding procedure, and basically we studied that with reference to Poisson's equation. Then we basically in these lectures we demonstrated few codes using freeware platforms like Gmesh and Scilab. Then we went on to solve Laplace and Poisson's equations in these 3 lectures, and basically we calculated leakage inductance of a power transformer, We calculated magnetizing inductance of an induction motor, and also
we understood
how we can use finite element method effectively for high voltage insulation design. Then in further lectures from 26 to 40,
we analyzed
many case studies and some extensions of standard and simple FEM formulations for Laplace and Poisson's equation to more complex cases involving axisymmetric problems, permanent magnets, eddy currents. Then
we also studied
how do we couple circuits and fields to solve practical problems which may involve transients and non-linearities. Then
we also got exposure to some advanced topics
in which we studied how do we do FE coding for simulating rotating parts, where that is basically rotor structure in a typical rotating machine. And we also studied how to impose periodic boundary conditions, which basically reduces computational burden. Then we went on to see how to compute torque speed characteristics of rotating machines, how do we impose tangential magnetic field excitation for some specific problems. For example, we studied how do we calculate effective complex permeability for analysis of core joints in transformers. And finally, we studied how do we calculate forces using two approaches, Maxwell stress tensor based approach and virtual work based approach. So in all, we had about 20 case studies throughout this course, and I hope this course will be useful to not only undergraduate and postgraduate students but practicing professionals for solving real life problems, either by developing their own course or by effectively using available commercial FEM software. Thank you very much.